My father, Reginald George Stopher, was one of eight boys and three girls, born to Robert Stopher and Mary Dibben of London, England. My dad met my mother, Irene Violet Scott Colson, and they married, and with their firstborn, my eldest brother Reggie, came out to Canada in 1912. They sailed on the Empress of Britain. They had desired to sail on the Titanic, but their plans were foiled somehow and they didn't, thank goodness. Otherwise, I wouldn't be telling you this story, probably. They came out to Victoria mainly because my dad's eldest brother, Robin, or Robert, and also his youngest brother, a younger brother that is, my uncle Bill, were working at the Empress Hotel. So this was their incentive to come out to Canada seeking a new life. Here are Mum and Dad arriving in Victoria with my brother Reg. We finally settled in the Mount Tommy district, and Dad built this house with Mum's help and designing things inside, the kitchen layout and everything like that. Mum was quite inventive. She came up with these carpets, these mats she made, as well as work in the garden. Mum and Dad both loved the garden. And Dad built an aviary in the bottom of the garden, canaries and everything in it, lovely. Here I am with my friend Phil Ellis on the right and Jean Phillips in the middle. My Aunt Nell came to visit us from New Zealand. She's on the far left. I go to school at Cedar Hill Elementary. One of my knitted sweaters Mum made for me. With Aunt Nell again, sticking our tongues out, not very nice. Now I'm at high school. Time flies. Another sweater that Mum knitted for me, turtleneck. My brother Reg in 1937 went to New York to try his talents. He played the guitar, sang and yodeled and dressed up and did funny little skits. He used to entertain in Victoria. I'm standing in front of our house, in front of Brother Eric's terraplane. I'm with Fred Norserly here, Fred and his motorbike. And out in front of the old CCF hall with some Mount Tommy friends. I love soccer, and our team won the league one year. We were that good. Here I am, dead center, with Robbie Williams on the left and Fred Norserly on the right. In 1938, I pedaled down to the border of California with Tom Ellis and Bill Court, met my uncle, who was wearing the leather jacket there. He was coming up from California. I'm arriving home now, coming off the wharf. In 1939, Fred Norserly and I went back to California again, to Los Angeles, and here we are under an orange tree. We had a great time seeing the sights. One last fling before the war. Now, little did I realize at this time that living in Victoria was a young lady by the name of Lynette Priestley. And she had come down to live in Victoria from northern British Columbia, where she had lived with her parents.
Yes. I was born in an Indian village of Ianch on the Nass River in northern B.C. My maternal grandfather was the Reverend James B. McCullough, the first white Anglican missionary in that area. He'd come out in 1883. And on one of his trips back to England, he had given a sermon.
He talked, didn't he, to a bunch of
people? Yeah, a sermon and saying how wonderful B.C. was and how much it had to offer. And my paternal grandparents must have gone to one of his sessions, and they got very enthused about the country, and they decided to come out. So they did. Meanwhile, their son had gone out when he was 17 to Alberta.
That was your dad.
Yeah. And he had worked, and I guess when he was about 21, that was the time they were up there, and he thought he'd better go up and see, check it out, he didn't trust his parents that they had good judgment, I guess.
That was about 1907, wasn't it?
I believe, yeah. So he went up, and there, in the meantime, Melita, my mother, had been born. She was the first white child to be born in that territory. So when he went up, he met Melita, and they were roughly the same age. And they fell in love, got married, and built a house on the edge of the river, overlooking the river, Nass River.
And had four kids.
And had four children, yeah. And I was the youngest one of that. The mighty Nass River in all its glory. Totem poles, native totem poles in the area. Typical Indian canoe with the old Indian and his wife. Another typical Indian family with their papoose. Dad's store with many bear skins trapped either by him or someone else. The house perched on top of the cliff overlooking the Nass River. It looks very precarious, but it lasted many, many, many years. This is another angle of the house with the wood supply. Hopefully they had a nice dry collection on the back porch, because that doesn't look like it's ready. This is the interior, the forerunner of the split level. Nice, eh? Mom and Dad and myself on a little bench outside the house. Me in my mosquito repellent outfit. Wasn't I funny? And I'm clutching a cat here we have in the family, my mom. This is a family picture. Dad's not in it because he was always taking the pictures. My brother Ken and myself on the beach, examining something, and me reading a book, or pretending to read. I always like to read. My sister, Kathleen, looking like Shirley Temple. Very cute. My dad operating a whip saw, a really different kind of a saw. And here's the family. We like to pretend we were on a cruise, I guess. Schoolhouse. Log schoolhouse, we had to leave and come down to Victoria because population diminished. So we moved down in 1929 to Victoria. Here I am in Victoria with two little friends I met. We've got our dolls. Here I am at Butchert's Gardens with my sister Kay. Don't you like our hats? And there was no entrance fee in those days. Another little friend I met. At school, I was about grade 3 at Girl Central School, and I'm still at Girl Central School here. And now I'm in high school, there in the middle, Victoria High School I attended. And here I am as a typical teenager, about 15 years of age, I think. And my two girlfriends in downtown Victoria in the 40s, holding hands.
Let us therefore brace ourselves to our duty. So bear ourselves that if the British Empire and its commonwealths last for 1,000 years, men will still say, this was their finest hour.
I'd always wanted to fly. While on my paper route, I used to go by the old airfield down and on Lansdowne Road, and seeing all the aircraft got me really enthused. And so when the war broke out, it was a natural thing for me to want to get into the Air Force. I didn't want anything to do with the Navy or the Army. So I went down to see if I could join up. And to my dismay, I found out that I didn't have enough education, because the Canadian Air Force at that time were only taking college graduates. This is for aircrew I'm speaking of. So I was very disappointed. But in the meantime, something had been going on that I had suddenly became aware of. There was a Captain Biggs in town, Henry Seymour Biggs, who would help young Canadians get over to England to join the Royal Air Force. And it seemed that the Royal Air Force were taking anybody. Education didn't seem to come into it too much. So I made a point of finding out about this Captain Biggs, and where he was. He had a little office downtown, and I went down to see him and met a lot of other young guys down there like myself who wanted to fly. And Biggs gave us an interview and asked us a few questions and told us what we could expect, all the discipline and everything. And I was accepted, and then he arranged for us to get our passports, and I went and got a passport photo, and before I knew it, I was on my way overseas. My mom and dad made a great sacrifice. They helped me get the money to go. It was $181.20, and soon I was on my way to Montreal. I sailed to the UK on the MS Mosru, a Norwegian ship. And on arrival in England, I went down to London and enlisted in the RAF at Euston House. And after some training, rifle drill and discipline training and that sort of thing, I was posted to RAF Cranwell for my wireless course. It was an interesting course, and when it was over, I was sent up to Peterhead on the east coast of Scotland, and then later to Oban on the west coast. While I was at Oban, I received word from my mom that radio station KIRO in Seattle wanted me to represent them and present toys and candy to bombed out kids in London. You'll have to read my biography, One Good Throw, for all of the details. My friend Roy Cook had come to England to join the RAF as I had done, and he and I met in Stratford-on-Avon, and that was the last time I saw him, for Roy became a bomber pilot, and in January of 1944, he was shot down and killed. I first learned of this while I was serving in India. On my leaves, I always went into London to stay with relatives, and here I am with my Uncle Sid and my grandma, Mary Stouffer. I relax there, fooling around with my cousins, Eileen, Doreen, and Marjorie. I always took the opportunity to write home, as I knew Mum and Dad enjoyed reading my letters and passing the news on to the neighbors. I was posted to the Far East in the June of 1942 and spent a few weeks in South Africa at Durban and Cape Town, experiencing life in a tent city at Clearwood Camp, riding the rickshaws pulled by Zulus. While in South Africa, I visited the Valley of a Thousand Hills, and this Indian chief didn't like me taking his picture. I was taking his image, so to speak, so he put a curse on me. From South Africa, on we went to India, and the first noticeable thing was the monument, the Gateway to India, on the harbor in Bombay. It was quite an experience to stroll the city streets and then, with full gear, head to the Northwest Frontier Province, which is now Pakistan. My station in the north, not far from the Afghanistan border, was Rizalpur, the nearest town being Peshawar. Here we had peacetime living quarters, ceiling fans and mosquito netting, with bearers to look after us. The charwalas were a daily occurrence, bringing tea and cakes to our place of work or to our billet. One day I took a day trip to stand on the rocks above the famous Khyber Pass for local transport into villages like Srinagar and Nowshera. We took rickety old buses driven by madmen. To earn a few pennies, a snake charmer put on a display for us with a cobra. While at Rizalpur, I donned battle dress and took a commando course with the 14th Army instructors, presumably to be attached to General Lord Wingate's Chindits, a group who operated behind Japanese lines. This never came to pass. Most of my time at Rizalpur was spent on flight servicing of aircraft and a bit of target drogue towing in a Westland Lysander for air-to-air firing practice for the new young Indian pilots.
We have bandits at Angels 10.
Benton, hello, Benton. One here, Angels 8, over.
I later moved south to Madras, where I worked in a mobile unit away from the field, doing ground-to-air communication with aircraft. When in town, one always used the rickshaw for cheap transportation. Later, I was posted to Calcutta, and then into Burma, to work on a mobile signals unit in the middle of paddy fields. This mobile life took up the rest of my war until transferred to the RCAF in May of 1945. Back to Bombay to transfer to the RCAF, and here I met good friend Tom Ball, who was from Winnipeg. We enjoyed time together while waiting to depart on the Queen of Bermuda for the United Kingdom. Then I was home again in Victoria in August of 1945 with old Mount Tommy buddy Fred Norserly.
While living in Victoria, we lived in several different homes. The first one was on Johnson Street between Camosun and Fernwood, and I was just little then. And the second one was on Minto Street, the bottom of Moss Street. And I went to Girls Central School and had to run down the hill for lunch and then puff back up again after lunch. Then we moved to Harrison Street, and there I attended Victoria High School, and I graduated from there in 1943. During this time, I spent many happy hours with my good friends Margaret Pryor, who was Margaret Spence, and Betty Jean Saunders, who is now Betty Jean Fair. We would jump on the old streetcar and head to town, where we would window shop or actually buy stuff, go to a movie, or just have a Coca-Cola and a piece of pie. Or I might walk around town with various boyfriends, including some of the sailors we met at the Cherub concerts in Beacon Hill Park, or Robert House Canteen. Bear in mind, it was during the war and I had not yet met Ken. I was still living at Harrison Street and working at Whittam & Company, real estate and insurance. Here I am outside the office with co-worker Doris Neal. I didn't really enjoy my job as a stenographer and typing up fire and auto policies, which involved math and calculating. Not one of my favorite subjects. I should have been a receptionist of some sort, as I always loved dealing with people. At the end of the war in 1945, one night my girlfriend Rose and I were walking past the Old Dominion Theater on Yates Street and noticed a friend standing in the lineup. He called us over to meet Ken Stopher, just back from India. They invited us to join them, and that was the beginning of my life with Ken. When I wasn't posing for sexy pictures, I was helping clear the land for our future home, tamping cement for the foundation, and we were not yet married. Soon the engagement appeared in the paper. We were married November 10th, 1947, in St. Aidan's lovely little church, since torn down. We left on the midnight CPR boat to Vancouver. On arrival, we boarded the Trailways bus, and for a cost of $38 each, we headed to Hollywood, California. We had a super time seeing the sights, movie stars, and an evening at the famous Earl Carroll's restaurant. We were on the show Meet the Misses as the couple who had been married the least amount of time, 2 days, 16 and a half hours, and won a prize of aluminum cookware. Our house gradually grew from foundation to walls, windows, and roof. At the time, we had a flat roof, as it was simpler for Ken to build. Mum Stopher sat on the chimney for a picture, and Ken sat astride his bike. Mum and Dad Stopher were caretakers at Bickerton Court, and we posed one day in the garden. Another time, we took a trip to Vancouver to visit Eric and Dorothy.
On one of our rare breaks from working on the house, we drove up island with Mum and Pop Stouffer, stopping for a picnic at Little Qualicum Falls. Some scenes around the old Mount Tommy neighborhood, Fred Ellis and horse-drawn milk cart. This dairy farm was located where the fairway is today. There used to be a corner store called Wilson's, formerly Hunter's Corner, now the Coast Capital Credit Union. At the corner of Cedar Hill Crossroad and Stamble was the old Merritt home, barn and garage, now Cloverdale Paint Store, and beyond that, Croft's Little House, later a pet clinic where Carol was working when Mark took our dog Jimmy for shots. Beyond that, the old Aiden's Hall, where Ken spent much time as a teenager playing basketball. While building our house, we lived with my mom and dad on Queens Avenue. We moved in 1949, and our first acquisition was a German Shepherd. We named him Rex. He used to guard the house, or pretend to, and he fetched groceries for us once in a while. And he fetched the paper. See, we don't even have a sidewalk there. Everything's very rustic. And he liked to look out the window and guard the house from inside as well. A lovely dog he was. Heard of that old song, Just Molly and Me, and Baby Makes Three. Well, it was Ken and me, and Terry made three. And she joined us in July 1951. And here's a couple of pictures of her as a little one. And then she was sitting on here she's at the beach. And later she was to sit on a horse, pretend horse, on a trip we were on. And then she was at the beach with Mummy, laughing her little head off. And I think it was probably about Parksville. There's our Austin. We got that about when Terry was about two. We finally got a car. Then Mark enters our life in April 1954. I forgot for a minute. And there's Terry, proud, very proud of her new little brother, beaming her head off. And there he is with his dad. This was on Father's Day. And there they are at Christmas, Mark's first Christmas, her spindly Christmas tree. And there's Terry with Mark in his stroller. She's probably going to take him for a little pretend walk anyhow. And they're nice little kind of Easter outfits. I didn't make them. I wasn't a knitter, but they had Easter bunnies on them. Mark with his first car, pedal car, that is. Yeah, I guess he was always car crazy. And here's a cute one of them sitting in our front room, giggling about something, happy as ever. And Mark was always kissing me as a little guy. He just loved to kiss his mummy.
Blame you.
No, really. And this is a Halloween pumpkin time. I think we grew all those pumpkins for some reason. And this is Easter. They're all dressed up and got their Easter baskets in front of a car of ours. And up island at Qualicum, I think, or Qualicum Beach Falls probably, Mark frowning. And Mark dressed up once again. See, he loves his little hat and tie and leather jacket.
And our Ford.
And this one I love. I just love this one. That's a nice picture. And then Terry had to have a knee operation on her knees. And these are all the nurses. And this is just before we went back east, our final picture there.
This is 1961.
Yeah. Okay, you can take off for that, Ken. That's when Olive and...
Yeah, 1961, Olive and Valerie visited us, and we had a picture of them taken up on the top of the Malahat. And there's Mark and myself and Olive.
Up island somewhere.
One of the campsites, yeah. And now we're into some movies here with Mark pushing Terry on a rope swing in our garden.
This was at some picnic.
This was a family outing with all the family. Dorothy, I think that is.
Yes.
I'm sure. And Uncle Bill trying to get the fire going. This was at the same time that Olive and Valerie were visiting with us. So just a nice outing at the beach.
I think it was Patricia Bay Beach, actually. Yeah.
or deep cool. Yeah.
Yeah. Barbecuing.
Oh, game of ball. Reggie was the catcher, and
no,
that was a
Mark.
It was Mark? Was
yeah,
it?
Mark.
Yeah, it was
yeah,
Mark.
Yeah, yeah. He's up to bat, running.
Well, he got two hits there, and we're walking. I don't know where we are here exactly.
Oh, I think over in Vancouver. Yeah, yeah, near that bridge.
Oh,
yeah.
Capilano.
Capilano.
Was it in Capilano
yeah.
Canyon?
Mm-hmm.
Probably. Yeah.
Yeah.
Danette and I go on holiday with Terry and Mark in the summer of 1962. First stop, Seattle World's Fair.
Next stop was Ianch, B.C., where my sister Kay lived, and I was born. I hadn't been back there since I was 4 years old, so it was quite exciting.
Said California is the place you ought to be, so they loaded up the truck and they moved to Beverly Hills, that is, swimming pools, movie stars. Well, now it's time to say goodbye to Jed and all his kin. And they would like to thank you folks for kindly dropping in. You're all invited back again to this locality to have a heap in heaven of their hospitality. Hillbilly, that is, set a spell, take your shoes off.
On our way home, we made one or two stops by the side of lakes and different spots just for a rest and to see the scenery. And
that's in Barkerville.
Yeah, walking through Barkerville. And then suddenly we're in Kamloops,
hot
evening by the river.
Terry's got the sun in her eyes there. Yeah. Still, it was a beautiful sunlit evening, wasn't it? Oh, there we are.
We're on a ranch here at Kelowna. We've got the trailer parked and in their field, and Terry and Mark are enjoying the horses and get a chance to have a little ride on a horse.
I think it was, Mark had a little ride up at Kay's, but it was the first time Terry had been on a horse, I think. Oh, me preening again.
Oops, splash. Mark goes into the water, Lake Okanagan. Doing his
dog paddle.
Yeah,
kind of.
Dog.
He hasn't taken lessons yet.
The overhand was yet to come. Oh. Terry's counting how long she can hold her breath. And now they're both displaying their prowess at floating, dead man's float. Oh,
another one of me. I get so fed up with these pictures, but Ken was always taking pictures
yeah.
of me.
And that's why we put them on here, because Lynette's fed up with them.
Oh,
here, I'm going to just swim across the lake.
There.
Uh-huh. Oh, more
family pictures.
Basking in the sun on the sand. I've just come back from swimming across the lake.
Right, resting.
Yeah.
Oh, there's Mark floating. Doing his is that his dog paddle? Dog paddle.
I think he's actually got his hands on the bottom.
But love that haircut. Isn't that cute? Right in style these days. We're going back home and we're going out to some do, all dressed up, in front of that picture we used to have on the wall. And that's sports day up at
This is a school up at campus.
There's Mark. Looks like he's... Oh, he's coming in last. Never mind, he tried. Terry and her friend Susan jumping up and down, so excited.
I guess the school won, even though Mark came in last.
Yeah, right. Yeah, maybe. Oh, back...
Oh, weeding the garden. They were always weeding the front there. We'd take them out and they're up again the next year, it seemed.
Yeah, we always were stupid to have all that.
Big project, that was.
Yeah.
We had 200 feet of waterfront.
I wish. This is the great ping pong caper. Terry and her friend Penny Schaefer.
They're trying to find the ball. Oh, she got it.
That time she did. Yeah. We had a lot of fun on that patio. Many, many happy times. Growing ups and kids and... Oh, now this is cute.
There it is.
She loses the ball.
She
goes around and... Then she gets annoyed.
And then in a while she's going to tell us what the score is, I think. How many games she's won. It's all lawn now, where that we used to play.
But it was nice when the kids were growing up. Have all their friends over. Oh, there's me again.
Miss Preen. Yeah.
Yes, and I've got great abs there, see? Abs being, you know, the abdominal muscles there.
Yeah. Absence makes a heart grow fonder.
Oh.
Our unfinished rockery. Look at that mess.
Yeah, we've worked very, very hard on that house.
The mess behind Lynette, that is.
Where are we now? But Parksville, I think.
Yeah.
And this great scene where Mark has to go to the bathroom, and he's hoping no one's watching. Anyhow, he made it.
Ooh, those.
It must have been very hard walking across those rocks.
They were either hot or they were sharp, those rocks.
And getting dried off at the end of the day.
And Mum's in a hurry to go home.
Yes. Oh, Mark pretending
these
to...
These are these huge weights that Mark's lifting, 50 pounds each.
Little plastic things. I don't think they even belong to us. And back home, and more pictures being taken of me performing.
Who were you throwing that ball to, anyhow?
I don't know. Somebody must have been throwing it back.
Yeah, we never saw who that was, did we?
Yeah. Saying something.
We got 1, 2, 3,
a Larry. 4, 5, 6, a Larry. Have to see if I can.
That was good exercise. You should do that now.
Oh, well, it's like learning to ride a bike. You never forget how to do 1, 2, 3, a Larry. I don't know whether the kids do it these days.
No.
Oh, now I'm trying it on the sidewalk. Yeah.
Better on the sidewalk.
You see, I felt I had to keep performing because Ken had the movie camera going.
Now she's
going to
show off. You watch this crafty behind. Oh, behind. That was clever, wasn't it? Yes, you finished yet? And I'll throw a ball in the air again. No. Bell.
Oh, now we're at Hornby Island.
This is a little raft we made up for the kids to play around on.
Or we found it there. Did we take a hammer with us?
I can't remember. We'll say for the sake of the story that we built it.
Anyhow, they had a great time.
Mark had this pole. He couldn't go out any farther than the length of the pole.
Oh, no.
Back at Shawnigan
Lake. Well, at least you're in that one.
Shawnigan Lake and Miss America again.
Oh, no.
Now she's rowing.
I really can row, and I enjoy rowing. Oh, there's Mark up on water skis for the first time. Doing very well. And there's with cousin Wendy, taking her for a little ride in the boat. This was great fun for them because they've never done anything like this before. And Uncle Reggie, that's Ken's brother
with his son, Dennis,
Mark's cousin. And here they're waiting for
Dennis.
Dennis to get up on skis and he's down.
And this is the son of one of the people that were living next door to us.
He was an expert.
Humphreys. Yeah, he was very good.
Terry and her friend Susan Taftree, and Terry taking Susan for a row. Terry attacked everything with great vigor, determination. There we go.
Susan. He was making sure. You should have worked for BC Ferries, you know, parking.
And this is our completed rockery, you know, we were working on so far.
Springtime, definitely, with all those flowers.
And then when we changed later, many years, it doesn't matter. There's old Belle after a bath. I guess she's looking a little scrumpy there.
It's probably before the bath. Oh, Mark broke his arm, tripped over a dog.
Yeah.
Neighbor's dog tripped him.
Yeah.
was a little experience.
Just a pose in front of the house for some reason. And oh, we used to have great fun at parties.
I made
parties.
A gorilla costume. And
well, your mom made the woolly part.
And I made the face. And we had parties, and there's Bill Ray looking through a toilet seat. We were always doing some kind of game. There's a gut bucket, Phil Ellis on the old gut bucket, like a bass fiddle type of thing.
It was a glamorous black dress I had.
Was that the same night? Maybe, I don't know.
Yeah, it could be. Oh, Ken Dancing. Ken Dancing! Well, that is... Put a mark on the wall for that.
Yeah. And now we're off back east in 65 to get a car. This is before we got on the train in Vancouver.
Ken loved train tracks. Pictures of that train tracks. This is only a portion of it.
Suddenly we're in Ontario. I remember it was Ontario, something to do with the lakes or Lake District or something. There was lots of water. We seemed to be going around this water area for the longest time.
It was nice and clean.
This is MacTier, Ontario, where the family, Mom and Dad, were many, many years ago. And we went to visit an old friend there.
There's Mark. Now he's really learned to do the overhand. Took lessons.
This is at a motel swimming pool. Mm-hmm. We were in Toronto at this point.
We were really living it up, I tell you.
Yeah. And now we've gone to Georgian Bay to see a friend of Lynette's, Reenie, who used to live in Victoria, and he lives there now. So that was a lot of fun. At least we had nice weather then, didn't mm-hmm. everything was seemed yeah. to hit just right.
Reggie, Margaret, Reggie's our sister-in-law. Reggie again, I think. Margaret and then Dennis.
Reggie couldn't have gone in the water there, could he?
Maybe not. Hmm.
Now the kids are really over drying for the sake of the movies. It seemed that if you had a movie, you had to make everybody move and do something.
Well, that's the idea.
And so they're really going to town here on their feet and their hair and making a big production. Oh, Niagara Falls. Well, lots of mist. We went out on the Maid of the Mist here.
Mm-hmm.
And it was quite an experience.
But the roar, the sound of the falls.
Yeah, we should have some waterfall sounds there. Coming off the Maid of the Mist. And this is where we ate in the restaurant and we had dirty forks.
Yeah, right.
Got them to take them back.
Well, we're at McTaggart's when they live back east.
Yeah, in Toronto.
You're pouring a beer and seeing, getting every good to the last drop. Oh, I think you did this for the picture.
No, I never. There's Betty McTaggart. And there's Mac. I was in India with Mac.
And now we're
leaving. Now we're leaving them.
Waving bye-bye. And they're standing. They had a second family. They had the two older ones and the two little ones.
Now in Detroit, as Cousin Ernest.
So we all went back on the train, both families, to buy cars. And it's nice to have that trip together and to meet cousins that we'd never met before. It was lovely. And they were very, very good to us. Oh, Reggie always had that.
Then we went out in their boat, and Ernest wanted to take me over to the Canadian side on the lake there. And, of course, I ran the boat aground and had to go over and fix it.
Well, he kept telling him, it's okay, okay. Now we're in a barbecue in their backyard with all their families.
He's making fun of me moving the zoom on the camera.
Oh,
and some dancing in the backyard. And then Ernest and Peg, they were good dancers. They went out a lot dancing, and they used to love it. Now we're in
another motel pool yes.
on our way home. We enjoyed that pool. That was a lot of fun.
We were really living
it. And we had very nice, we had hot weather, and it was just ideal for that type of a trip. It's always nice at the end of the day to stop at a motel and have a pool. Mm-hmm. Now we're in Winnipeg with Tom Ball, who I was also in India with, briefly, in Bombay when we transferred to the airport.
That's either whipped cream or sugar.
I think it's whipped cream, I hope. There's an awful lot of sugar. It's an awful lot of everything. And that's Mary, Tom's wife. She really provided a lovely meal.
And we're around Edmonton here, I think.
Yeah,
a zoo.
Place there.
And then up to Banff. It's a sulfur mountain. We're going to walk up the mountain. And we're all very happy and getting along well here.
Our first fight, Ken and I.
And look at the nice picture that Lynette took of me. She did it perfectly. Everything was just right, and I didn't have to worry about whether she was using the right buttons.
Now we're home.
And Belle's,
I still don't know who looked after Belle.
Belle, that doesn't matter anyhow, but yeah. Belle was there when we got back, and she was sure glad to see us.
Yeah.
And we were glad to be home again.
Ken, of course, is...
That was a good trip.
The end.
We loved that trip.
I knew that was on there somewhere. Oh, now
that's
it's time
to wash Bill. He hasn't been washed since we've been away,
she.
I guess.
She.
Or she, all right. She. Well, what's an S?
Makes a big difference to the dog. We had this little metal dishpan thing we washed her in.
I got to lift him up. Ooh, that was heavy.
Her up.
Her up. Okay, him, her, what the deal? He might just as well have been either. He didn't seem to do much. She didn't seem to do much.
Poor Belle. She was rather elderly. I think she was 11 years old when we got her.
Yeah.
So.
She left.
You needed a shave.
She loved to have a nice bath, though.
Yeah. See?
It's the camera angle.
No,
I think it's
you needed a shave.
Well, I was squeezing in my busy schedule, you know, having to go to work, wash the dog, and trying to fit in time to shave and everything. It was
and taking
busy.
Pictures of me.
Yeah.
Right. When are you rinsing her off with a teacup?
Ooh, doesn't he look all... She look all... flibbity-flop. She was kind of what you call a dormant dog, wasn't she? So,
or a doormat.
Yeah. Oh, he's getting double rinse here. It's just not a flicker out of her, you know. That could have been anything poured on her. Hot water, cold water, vinegar.
Well,
I think I'll just...
Now Terry's giving her a good rub. She did look lovely for about an hour.
She had a nice coat when it was all nice and clean and fluffy.
There.
There's a nice bright smile. Oh, what action. She can... Good job it was going down and not up.
Oh, then there's a lovely picture.
Yeah, Belle.
And Ginger the cat and Belle
and, Ginger,
and Mark.
Yeah. Oh, there's a nice picture, too.
Oh. We used to have a lot of tulip bulbs. We bought a lot, hundreds of them, planted them all
up. I'm glad we got that picture of you. We don't have very many of you.
That's right.
Yeah. Oh, there's another one. Yeah.
Oh, I think I'm pulling dandelions.
We had a very colorful garden, I must say, in the front there. It was very nice.
A lot of work, but it paid off.
Yep.
England swings like a pendulum do. Bobby's on bicycles two by two. Westminster Abbey, the Tower of Big Ben. The rosy red cheeks of the little children. Now if you huff and puff and you finally save enough money up to take your family on a trip across the sea, take a tip before you take your trip. Let me tell you where to go. Go to England, oh, England.
Here we are in Chelmsford, England. My first trip back to England since the war. We're with my Uncle Jimmy, Uncle Sid, we know him as Jimmy, and his family, Valerie and Nora, his wife, in their back garden, enjoying the sunshine. It was fun being back in England and meeting them. And now we are off to Harwich to take a ferry across to the Hook of Holland, which is a little peninsula out the a little ways from Amsterdam. And after we dock there, then we go into Amsterdam. We're on the ferry here, walking the deck and anticipating our wonderful time on the continent.
Okay, now we're in, after we picked our car up, and then we're going to Amsterdam. And this was a Renault, or Renault, whichever you want to say. Here we are, we're going, candid camera pictures taken by a guy. We're going to go on the canal trip. Terry looks, oh, there we are, looking typical tourist. It was a lovely trip on that canal.
One of the trips, I think, took us out to Rotterdam, as I remember. The docks, the famous docks. And that was interesting to see all the ships out there.
Hard to realize there's all these canals, you know, going through the town. I think we're going to either a...
We're approaching Anne Frank's house, I think. Or else we're coming back to... No, we're coming back to our hotel. Yeah, there's our hotel. There's Mark going in. Now, everyone rode bicycles, it seemed. Everywhere, right through town.
Businessmen, housewives with their shopping, and maybe secretaries. There's a mother with her two kids going through that traffic. I couldn't get over that. There's Anne Frank's house.
Yeah, Anne Frank, you'll remember from World War II. And
we went actually went up and saw where she hid out, and the family hid. This is the Autobahn.
Autobahn in Germany. Yeah, we're heading into Bavaria. We heard a lot about that place in Rotterdam.
Some lady taking her bread home for dinner. That's the Eiffel Tower.
We went right to the... Well, we didn't go to the top. We went to about the third level, I think it was. Most interesting.
All the mechanics of it, too.
So there's Mark and Terry up on the third level looking down over Paris. A great view. If the weather's clear, it's a wonderful viewpoint to look all over Paris.
Champs-Élysées. Oh, Harry Disbrow, no.
Harry, no, yeah.
Yeah, right.
And oh, and suddenly our trip's over in the continent.
We're back
to Chelmsford. With Valerie and her friend of that time in their back garden. It was nice to be back there, though, and have a home-cooked meal with Jimmy and Nora. And then we found ourselves later on going into London and walking through the streets. And
the
going
kids wanted to see Carnaby Street. They'd heard all about it, so down we went. It was all right, a bit crowded and some exciting shops for young people, I guess.
It was the era of the short skirts.
Right.
They'd just been introduced.
Then we went to visit Aunt Maud in Pinner, just outside of London. She's Ken's mother's sister. Dear old soul. They're just delightful. There she is with Mark. Mark's looking a little bit uncomfortable, but he's putting up with it. She's such a sweetheart. As a matter of fact, we have a bit of a tape with Maud speaking on it, which is very nice to have and nice to look back on.
To understand this all our talking. We've had a lovely evening, and I do hope you're going to have a good night's rest now after this.
Oh, and Mark and Ken went to Battersea Park.
Yeah, Battersea Park, and we posed for these pictures. And this was the day of
glimpse.
the changing of the guard at Buckingham Palace in London.
Yeah.
And now another day we went out to Windsor Castle.
Hampton Court.
Hampton Court? I thought it was Windsor Castle.
Get it right.
Okay, all right. I thought we went to Windsor, but okay.
And we're walking along. Yeah, beautiful grounds. We didn't think that much of the building itself, did we? Oh, this was the family gathering at Laurie and Marjorie's.
No, it wasn't. It was at their gathering, but it's Brian and Lenore we're looking at here. Brian has passed on now, and his wife Lenore, who we still correspond with. And Uncle Bill was on this visit with us. And was that Angela?
That's Angela.
Angela, that's Bill, not sure where he is.
They'll all parade by after, but there's everybody
there. They're all Stouffer's, anyhow.
Yeah, all Stouffer's. Nora and Terry taking pictures of people, and Ken Brooks and Nigel and Angela and Valerie. Yeah, it was a lovely time seeing them all. And
we're having the
parade by Nora and Bill, Ken and
me, you, us.
Us, Kissy Poo.
Yeah.
There's
Ardell and Ivy, wouldn't it?
Edie. Olive's mum.
Olive. Aunt Nell and Marjorie.
Yeah.
And Laurie's father on the back side there with Brian.
This won't mean anything to forthcoming generations.
That's Marjorie.
Yeah.
And
Rob's wife, he's a cousin. And Jennifer, that's Angela's sister. And
Martin.
And David.
David.
And David has since passed away.
He was killed in a plane crash.
Yeah, sadly. That's his mom.
Eileen,
Ken's cousin. Her son, another son.
Nigel. There's Ken husband, himself, the lawyer.
Ken Burke.
The solicitor.
Yes. And Angela again, doing her little...
Angela likes walk. It's Brian and one of the children. I don't know whether it's Mark or whether it's Paul.
Yeah. And Olive's mother. Olive is another cousin, and that's...
Cousin Eric.
And that's Lori, that's Marjorie's
husband.
And Uncle Jimmy and his sister.
Aunt Eva.
Yeah.
Eva, my aunt
Doreen's
Eva.
Doreen's mother. We're getting ready to take off on our own, and Valerie's taking a picture of Mark and Terry, quite cute. And then she sent us a copy of it, and look, it turned out really good. Look at the kids in those sunglasses. They thought they were really cool. And then we put a maple leaf on the back of our rented car so that all the people in Britain would be aware. Then we're going through Chester, and we see this lady directing traffic, looking very officious, didn't she?
Mm.
Telling everybody where to go. Oh, and then we got to Hadrian's Wall. Now, this was a big thrill for Mark. He'd read about it in school and heard about it.
Built by the Romans in Roman times.
Yeah, he's walking along. I don't know what those white... Oh, and then we had a friend, a daughter, a friend of Ken's he was in the services with, and she toured us around York, the walled city. So that was a fascinating time. Very nice of her. And then we got to Stonehenge. We've missed, you may think we've missed a lot, but we just showing the highlights. And
we were here with my Aunt Ethel on the left there and my Uncle Len on the right. Yeah, Uncle Len is...
another brother of your dad.
Yeah, Jimmy's brother to my dad's brother.
They all look alike, don't they?
Stonehenge we were able to walk right into in those days.
Oh, and then we went down into London. And we're in Trafalgar Square feeding the pigeons. I thought that was great, them all landing on. And Mark, look at him. Pigeons
they
all
got
over.
All over Mark. I don't know whether he's wearing a lot of badges there or not.
Yeah, or it's white stuff.
Pigeons badges, I guess you call them.
Even on one his on his head.
One make a nest, I think. There.
And then he climbed up on those lions in Trafalgar.
Lions in Trafalgar Square.
It was quite an experience for the kids. He's all dressed. Oh, now we're home.
We're home again.
All over. And Reggie's helping us unpack there.
And Uncle Bill, he's still not sure where he is.
Still in a daze. Poor Uncle Bill. I think he was a bit senile at the time.
And it sure was good to be home. I said phew when I got home.
The end, of course.